Hey everybody. Today I'm concluding the mini-series on how to back up your data. So if you haven't watched my previous videos, go and do that. I talked to you about how we use a 3-2-1 backup strategy. We want 3 copies of data, 2 locally on different machines and 1 remote. This video is going to focus on that remote, assuming that you've already backed up locally. And for this video, I'm going to introduce a new tool, rClone. I've been using rClone for years. You've probably heard of it, but I really recommend you get familiar with it because it's an excellent tool for doing secure and efficient remote backups. I'm going to take you through how you can install this from executable files to Docker deployments. We're actually going to focus on a Docker deployment in this video, and I'll walk you through the config first. I'll get you set up with all of the parts that you need to change to tweak it for your setup. I'll then show you what it looks like when you deploy it. Then I'll help you set up a remote. A remote in this context is your cloud provider, but do note that you can use rClone locally. It simply backs things up from location A to location B. Once we have our remote set up, I'm going to show you how to use this for Google Drive, but there's instructions for all the different providers. We'll then have a look at how you can actually upload something using rClone. And finally, I'll show you how to mount that remote locally so that you can access your cloud storage as though it was a local drive on your machine. Now I'm going to share with you a couple of configs for Docker. One is just a vanilla setup with no mount, and that requires the fewest permissions. But it will give you a GUI interface as well, which is really handy if you want to just check your remotes, if you want to look at your uploads, all of that good stuff. I'll also provide a second config for Docker, which will include a mount, but do note that you'll need to run it as a privileged container if you want to have a mount. So depending on your security risk appetite, that might not be for you. You could always mount that just locally on the host anyway, just using another instance of rClone. So let's jump into rClone without a mount first. So the configuration is really straightforward, actually. There's very few parameters we need to look at. We're not going to specify a port here, but if you need to, go ahead and specify one as you would a normal container. I'm going to run this through my traffic proxy so that I can get to the dashboard using SSL and all of those benefits. If you don't know how to do that, go and check my other video. I'll show you how to set up a traffic container. The most interesting part here is probably that command. Now, what's a command? It's basically something that runs when this container is set up. So as the container is deployed, it will then run rcd rc web GUI. So that command is going to run a web GUI. Now, it's going to run that on port 5572. It's going to actually pull down the web GUI from GitHub and build it in real time. I should note that it's not the slickest UI, but it's more than functional. So maybe this will develop over time. I hope it does, but it works. It's going to ask you for a username and password. So just populate that with something that you know. You're going to be able to specify how many transfers you want to be able to do in parallel. So this basically means if you have 100 files, how many do you want to be able to do in concurrent? Do you want to do one by one? Do you want to do 2 at a time, 3 at a time, 4 at a time? It's up to you. I do 4. That seems to be a sensible for my bandwidth, but you could probably do more if you have a higher bandwidth, for example. After that, we want to make sure that we get the volumes right. And there's kind of 2 main volumes that we need for this. One is the configuration file, and I'll go through that in a moment. And secondly, is the repository that you want rClone to have access to. Now, this will probably be where you want the data backing up from. i.e. it could be a mounted NAS share, it could be a local repository on your host, your VM, where you store all of the data that you care about. So the config is basically where you're going to store your remote credentials. So in this instance, we're actually going to create the remote outside of this Docker container. We're going to do it in Windows first, but you can also do this on Linux. You just need to create the config file. We're then going to take that config file and mount it into the container. The rest of the config just shows you the labels that are used for traffic so that we can put this behind a reverse proxy. If you don't have a reverse proxy and you don't want to use one, simply remove the labels section, add a port as you normally would for a container, and you'll be able to access it through the IP in the port. So moving on to the second config, where we actually load rClone with a mount, i.e. it's going to load our remote to our host so that we can access it. That might be useful if you're storing large volumes of data off-site and you want to have access to it, you want to make ad hoc changes, etc. And there's quite a few changes we need to make this work within a Docker environment. The first thing to note and make you aware of is that you need to run this as a privileged container. And you can see that where we specify privileged as true. And we also specify that we don't want any app armor on this, which is a Linux constraint for trying to add security around applications. I won't go into that in too much detail. We also, in this instance, need to have some supporting software on the host itself. We need to make sure that we're using Fuse, which is a tool for mounting within Linux. And we also need to create a new bind mount. So somewhere it's going to mount our remote to our host. A bit like if you watched in my previous video, when we mounted our TrueNAS share into our Docker host. We also need to give it the sys admin permissions, again, because it needs admin privileges. And lastly, we need to add another command to the Docker container. In this instance, we're telling it how to mount, or should I say, which remote to mount to the host. And then we have some additional parameters, such as the buffer size, the number of checkers, transfers, how far to read ahead. I'm not going to go into too much of those details, but I do recommend you go and read up on those on the rClone website. There isn't one recommendation that I can give you. It's all down to your bandwidth and your hardware, so you'll have to do a bit of trial and error. So now that we've walked through the configs, we need to go and create our remote and actually grab our config file that will then mount into whichever you choose to deploy. So this config is required no matter whether you're using the dashboard or no dashboard, whether you're choosing a mount or no mount, you're going to need this config. So let's hop into Windows and do this now. But as I said, you can do this in anything that has a command line. Okay, so let's start the installation process. I recommend you grab a brew. This is going to take a while. The first thing we need to do is head over to the rClone website, because we need to download rClone to create the config file first. So head on over, go to the download section, and just download the version that's right for your operating system. I'm going to be doing this on Windows, but it will be the exact same process for any operating system that's supported. And once it's completed, you want to extract it to a folder. So with that downloaded and extracted, we can now begin the configuration process. Remember, the first thing we need to do is create that config file. So go ahead and open the terminal by shift right clicking in a blank space in the folder and clicking open in terminal. With the terminal open, you're going to want to type .rclone.exe, and then you want a space and config. And then it's going to say that there's no remotes. Well, that's what we expect, right? Because we've never used rClone before. So we want to hit N to create a new remote. Give your remote a name. I'm just going to call mine Google Drive because that's what I'll be using. Feel free to name it after whatever solution you're after. Once you hit return, you're going to get a list. Now, there's 50 in the list at the time of making this video. And that's pretty awesome, right? I said at the start that rClone has multiple different backup sources that you can use. So for me, I just want to go and find Google Drive. So let's look in that list until we see it. And here we can see it's at 18. So we simply want to enter the number 18 for our storage solution. It's then going to ask for a client ID. Now, we don't have a client ID, so let's go and fix that. What we need to do is go to the rClone website, find the instructions, which is ultimately going to send us to the Google Cloud API. So let's just see that. So on the rClone website, it tells you quite clearly that you need to go to the Google Developer Console. So let's head there and create a new project so that we can get a client ID and secret to hand over to rClone to link the two services. So when you come to Google, you're going to be logged into the developer console and you're going to want to create a new project. So simply click at the top, click new project, give your project a name. I'm just going to call mine rClone YouTube, and then hit create. That might take a little while to create, usually sort of 30 seconds to a minute. But when it's ready, click the drop down at the top, select your new project. So with your project created, the first thing we're going to have to do is to enable an API service. So for this, I'm going to want to enable the Google Drive API service. So that's as simple as clicking at the top, enable APIs and services, and then finding Google Drive API, and then just hitting enable. Once that's enabled, it's going to return you back to the home screen. And once you're back on the home screen, you're going to want to click the OAuth consent screen. You're going to want to select an external app. And then you're going to want to give your app a name, a user support email address, and finally, developer contact information email address. Once you've entered those, just hit save and continue. Then you're going to want to do add or remove scopes. Now, in the filter, type in drive. And according to the documentation, you want to add the auth docs and the auth drive. And you may want to do the metadata read only. Once you've done that, hit update. And then you can save and continue. For your users, just add yourself. And then hit save and continue. The next step, we're going to create our credentials. So this will create the client ID and the secret that we've just been asked for in our rClone config. So create credentials at the top. You want to select OAuth client ID. The application type is going to be a desktop application. And you're going to hit create. Now, you want to copy these into a notepad. We need to keep these safe because we're already being asked for the client ID in the rClone config. And once we put that in, it's going to ask us for the client secret. So keep hold of these in the notepad and keep them secure. They will be stored in your rClone conf afterwards. But again, you don't want to lose these. If you lose these, you're going to lose access to your Google Drive. So once you've stored those somewhere secure, just hit OK. And then you want to go back to your OAuth consent screen and you want to click publish your application. Now don't worry, this isn't actually going to publish it like a normal application or anything like that. It just means that you can now start using it using the credentials that you've just created. Now it does warn usually about it can take a number of days to do this, but irrespective, you can go ahead and start using this right away. So let's head back now to our command line and put in the details that we've just created. So now where it's asking for that client ID, let's paste the client ID that was provided for us. So then hit return. And then it's going to ask us for the secret that we just created. So paste that in afterwards. And then hit return. Now it's going to ask us what level of access do we want to grant it. Now in this case, I want to give it full access to all applications, all files, folders. So I'm going to hit number one. You can choose a different option that suits your use case. It's going to ask for a service account file. Ignore that and just leave it as blank. We don't need that for this. It's going to ask if you want to edit the advanced config. Now, you can go and have a look in there and change some of those values. For this tutorial and the way I actually run it myself, I'm going to leave this as no. I don't need to change any of that. So just hit return. The default is no. Now it's going to try and authenticate this session and future sessions by logging into your Google account. Let's do that because it's going to use the browser and it will make it really easy. So here I'm going to log in with my Google account. Make sure it's the Google account that you just created the new project and got the client IDs, otherwise it won't work on a separate account. It's going to say that Google hasn't verified this application, and that's quite right. Don't worry about that. Just click go to the next page, and then click continue. Once you've done that, you're going to get a success message in the top corner. Great, that means everything worked. So let's head back to our command line. Now in our command line, you can see that it's updated. You can see that it pulled down a link and an authorization state, and it's now ready to go to the next stage in the configuration. It's asking whether we want to set this as a shared drive. We don't, so just hit return. The default is no. And now it's confirming all of the information, the client ID, the secret, and then the access token, which is created when you logged in through the browser. So this keeps that session alive for future sessions. Do we want to keep this remote? Yeah, this is fine. This is working. So I'm going to hit return. So now you'll be taken back to the main menu, and it's going to show you that you've now got a remote called Google Drive. Awesome. So now we have a working config file that we can now add and mount into our Docker container. So let's go ahead and do that. The first thing we need to do is find the config now on the machine we've just created it. So in Windows, that's located in C, users, your username, app data, roaming, and then rClone. And you can see it here. So if we double click that, you can see all of that information that was provided in the command line interface here. So what we want to do is open up WinSCP, and we want to copy this config file to wherever you've specified in your Docker Compose file. So for me, I've just put it in Docker and then in my rClone folder, and I've actually put that in the config folder. So if I just right click and copy this and then paste it into my config file, now we should be in a position where I can spin up my container. So let's try that now. So now that we can see that the container's started, so let's go and see if we can access that. Excellent, looks to be working. So if I log in there and click my Explorer, it's already got my Google Drive, and yeah, it's empty because I'm not using anything. So in here, I've just navigated to a folder that I have in my other rClone, my Kubernetes setup, just to demonstrate how you can create a new file. So just click upload. Here's an image. We're going to upload that. Click upload. You can see it's transferred in the bottom corner. You can't, my face is in the way. But if we've refreshed this, you can see here it's created that new file. So actually, if we want to click that, we can download it. Let's click that. There's the image that I uploaded. So excellent, everything seems to be working. We can also just delete that if we don't want that anymore. So just hit delete. So that's great. We've got access now. We've got the ability to upload and download files. Now, one thing in my GitHub that I've created for you is the ability to do a remote command to this Docker instance. What does that mean? Well, because we're running this in Docker, we might want to tell it to do updates remotely, i.e. I'm on my Windows machine now. This Docker instance is running on a separate machine. We don't want to have to exec into the command line to run an update. We might just want to send an update message to this container. So to do that, there's two things that we need. Now, if you head over to my GitHub and go into the rClone folder, you'll see the sync script. You want to add this sync script into a folder that you mount inside the container. So for example, in my container, you can see it's mounted here. Now, if you don't want to be able to do remote backups, just remove that. You don't need this, but it makes a lot of sense. You want to be able to do it from anything. You can even do this from remote desktop off your phone to create this. You can even use it for scripts and cron jobs, etc. So you can do this at automated times. To take advantage of this, you want to go back to the rClone folder and you want to click on that remote upload. Now, this is a Windows batch file that you can use to run that command. It's simply going to update whatever folder you've got synced to your data folder. You can put some excludes in there as well, which might be quite handy. There might be certain files or folders you don't want to back up. It's going to say which remote do you want to go to. We've only got the one remote, that's the Google Drive, but rClone works with multiple, so you can specify here which one you want to use. You're going to say where's the remote address, so this is the IP or the DNS entry of your Docker container. You're going to specify username and password because it's an authenticated command. And then there's a couple of others, which I'm not going to get into this, but it's basically saying how it uploads, how many transfers in parallel, those sorts of things. So with both of those added to your container, you can now do remote backup. You can add files, you can amend files, you can rename them. And for most people, this might be enough. So for the next piece of the puzzle, what if we want to mount our container to our Docker host? Now, why would we want to do that? Well, we might want to access some of the files in our remote on our host. We might have storage constraints, size constraints, etc. We might not be able to fit loads of hard drives into our machine. We might not want to. If we've got a robust cloud storage solution, why not use that? So I'm going to show you how to do that. So let's go to where we stored our mount Docker Compose file. But before we run it, there's just a couple of things we want to check. For this to work, you're going to need to have Fuse installed, and you'll see that within the Docker config file, that /dev/fuse. Fuse is a kernel module for mounting files to the Linux host. So make sure you've got that. In the version of Ubuntu I'm using, it comes pre-installed, so we don't need to worry about that. But if you're using a different Linux distribution, just make sure that you've got that installed. The second thing we're going to need to do is a bit like in our TrueNAS video, when we mounted that to our Linux host, we need to make sure that the folder we're mounting to actually exists. So in my instance, I need to create a folder in my home directory. And I'm going to call this file /google/drive_nas_crypt. Now, that last word is funny. And I'll come onto that in a minute. That's because mine is encrypted, and I'll show you how to do that at the end of this video. This folder can be whatever you want to call it. Just make sure it's consistent and it's the one that you specified in your config file. So for example, in the one that I've provided, that would be this folder here. So if we now go and deploy that container, we can see that the container started, looks fine. Let's check that folder we created. And there we go, we have access to all our files and folders on our remote, on our Docker host. So now we can start to mount these files into some of our other containers, which might be great for things like Plex or Jellyfin, any kind of media server, or pretty much any combination. So how do you mount this on Windows? Well, it's pretty straightforward. To mount this on Windows, you're going to need to install WinFSP. So let's go and do that. Simply click on the link, hit the download button, download WinFSP, and you're good to go. So to actually use this, I've created a script that you can use. So if you head over to my GitHub, you can see that I've created a Windows mount bat file. So simply copy this, change it to match your folder structure and remote name, and you can assign whatever drive letter you want to. So I've done G here. So let's see this in action. So here I've copied that GitHub file into an rClone mount.bat file. And if I simply double click that, it loads up a command window. Just keep this open. Otherwise, if you close this, it's going to disconnect your mount. And if you look in Windows Explorer, you can see that I now have a G drive. And if I click that, you can see my NAS. And now you can see that I have the exact same files available to me here in Windows as I do on my Linux host. So excellent. We've got the same remote accessible to all of our devices now. And I'm not going to cover it in this video, but you could actually share that remote on your Docker environment as maybe a Samba share across your network. The possibilities pretty much are endless. So the last bit we need to cover is encryption. So how do we do that? Thankfully, it's not too scary. Let's get into it. Let's head back to that command line instance we used to create our first config file. And simply this time, we're going to create a new remote. we're going to call it something with crypt in the name. I'm just going to call it crypt to make it easy. And then we're going to have to choose which remote it is again. So this time, handily, there is a special one for remote, and it's number 14. So put in 14. It's going to ask you which remote you want to use. So we've already specified the Google Drive. So I'm going to say Google Drive. And then the path I'm going to specify as just a slash, because I want it to encrypt everything within my share. If you just want this to apply to a specific file or folder, you can go ahead and do that. Now, I want to encrypt file names and folders. So I hit one, and then I hit one again. And then it's going to ask you to generate your password and your salt. Now, these are effectively your encryption keys. So I'm just going to auto-generate here, but you can use your own if you want to. It's then going to ask you for a salt. So again, I'm just going to generate those here in the command line. Once you've done that, you'll be asked whether you want to edit the advanced config, just as before. I'm going to hit no. We don't need to change anything here. And then we want to keep this crypt remote. So now you'll be presented back to the main menu, and you'll have your Google Drive, and it'll be of a type drive, and you'll have your crypt, and it'll be of type crypt, because that is an encrypted access point to that Google Drive type drive. So now, how do we use that? Well, it's quite simple. We simply go to wherever we've specified our remote. In the past, that's being Google Drive. And in this case, I would simply change that remote's name to crypt. It's really that simple. So let me just show you how to do that. So in that command I previously showed, instead of having Google Drive here, I just type crypt. And from now on, it's going to mount that crypt remote instead of my other one. And I know that anything I upload, change, download, access is all going to be encrypted at rest, which is great for privacy. Google aren't going to see what I'm doing. Excellent. So now that we've done that, we have a fully working Dockerized rClone instance that we can both upload, download, and mount files to. We've got configs for doing remote operated uploads, and you've got all of the configs that you can tweak to make sure you're able to do that. So anytime you run that Windows batch file now, it's going to upload anything that you've got in that mounted data directory. So excellent. You've now got encrypted, remotely available Google Drive or whatever storage solution you're using on your host environment mounted as though it's a local drive. Now that's a lot to take in, and trust me, it was a lot harder to make. So just go through the video, watch it a few times if you're unsure, just familiarize yourself with all of the config files. And if you found this helpful, please leave a comment, give it a thumbs up, and maybe consider subscribing. It really means a lot to me. Anyway, I'm going to take a much needed break. I'll see you on the next video. Take care, everybody.